Mario Van Peebles is with us, and we'll talk in a bit about his successful film of a while back, New Jack City, but let's talk about the one that's coming up, which is Posse, and you take a look back at the Old West, but from a new perspective.
It's sort of in the revisionist tradition of Westerns. Posse is different because I think it's one of the first films that really looks at the West, maybe more honestly. A lot of people don't know, almost one out of three cowboys were black, because what happens was when after the Emancipation Proclamation, the slaves were freed, a lot of folks went up north, said, let's get out of the South.
Yeah.
A lot of folks went up north, but they also went out west.
After I finish my business out west, I'm going to go up to Canada, go to them Dakota territories, and let things cool off. Now, y'all want to ride with me, that's okay. Don't ask no questions that need answering. Don't get in my way.
I'm with you, Jesse.
Oh, I'm definitely with you, Jesse. I'm definitely with you.
Big groups of Afro-Americans moving out west, migrating out west, and a lot of them were put on Indian reservations, which is why almost 90% of Afro-Americans have Native American blood. I didn't know why I had so much Indian blood. So Posse explores a lot of the early black towns, the 44 settlers, the original settlers of Los Angeles, for example, 26 of them were black, but we never saw that in movies.
Of course, when it comes to Westerns, historical accuracy is almost impossible. So really, I guess what you would be getting a shot at is your piece of the mythology mixed in with history, because no, quote, white Westerns are historically accurate either. It's all about mythology.
Yeah,
right?
It is. I mean, one of the first things that we opened the movie with a section with Woody Strode, and one of the first things that Woody says, Woody Strode being, of course, the guy that was in Spartacus, was in Once Upon a Time in the West.
Yeah.
Woody's now almost 80 years old. And Woody says something very interesting. He says, you know, history's a funny thing. And they got us believing that Columbus discovered America, but the Indians were already here. That's like me saying, I'm going to discover your car and I'll call you an evil red savage if you don't give me the keys quick enough. So we go into that part of history, you know.
Yeah.
It's almost as if someone, you imagine 90 years from now, someone were to dig up the Rocky movies and go, hey, look, all the heavyweight champs must have been white guys. You know, it's just Hollywood colors things, you know. I think now what's interesting is with Dances with Wolves, Kevin Costner treated the Native Americans differently. With Clint and Unforgiven and having Morgan Freeman in there, it's not just politically correct casting, it's historical fact. There weren't that many Afro-American cowboys in the West. The very term cowboy was a derogative term. See, they used to let the slave hands deal with the livestock, naturally. So if you were a slave and you were dealing with the cows, they called you boy. They called them cowboys. That's where the name cowboy comes
from.
So it's a different Western in that anytime you deal with history and you look at it differently, people go, oh, wow, I didn't know that.
And African-Americans represented across the full spectrum. They're good guys, they're villains,
exactly.
Just as they were. I mean,
exactly.
It only makes sense that they'd be represented among the outlaws as well.
Exactly. Well, the thing is, at that time, you also had laws that were passed. When the black towns started to get a little power and these folks were moving out and saying, we're not looking for welfare, we're not looking for a handout, when they started to build these towns, the government, partly in response to these towns and these guys voting and doing all this stuff on their own, passed laws like the Grandfather Clause. And the Grandfather Clause said that if your grandfather didn't vote, you couldn't vote. So if your grandfather was a slave, or if your grandfather was an Indian chief, you couldn't vote. So they were systematically discouraged from voting or owning property, and now Jack Kemp, who was in Bush's cabinet, says 12% of Afro-American, of America is Afro-American. 12% of our population is black. And that 12% owns less than one half of 1% of America's wealth. So now, what you have in Posse, which is very interesting, and is a theme I really wanted to explore, was the first start of that systematic disempowerment. And you have people who just have, you know, they thought the American dream was for them. Even though they were slaves, they said, we can still make it, we can still get out there, the laws will be on our side, they'll protect us, and boom, the land was taken away and the voting privileges were taken away, and now you got a lot of folks out there who don't vote and who don't own any property. And if America's built on capitalism and democracy and you take part in neither game, when you're shown injustice like the King situation, you tip the checkerboard over because you've never gotten to win the game anyway. The game has never been fair. Why I was, my long amble here was why I was interested in doing Posse was it was the very first examples of those black towns really being crushed. Now, you can't make a movie about that. That's just the backstory. You gotta have fun and kick butt and it's action. It's interesting because there's a situation in Posse that's sort of akin to the parallel to the Rodney King beating, except for the victim is white and the perpetrators of the crime are white. So it takes that Afro-American audience and forces them to fall in love with Stephen Baldwin, who they had never related to, crosses them over that way, takes that white audience and forces them to understand Afro-Americans they wouldn't have understood, and you mix it.
Say, Jesse Lee, what'd you do back in the States to kind of like you so much?
What the hell is this?
What is that? Damn, who turned out the lights? Just a little humor. Have to admit I'm funny, ain't I?
I read where you said, and as I read it, it was a good-natured observation, not an angry one. Aren't going to be any black Rambos, aren't going to be any black Eastwoods, at least not in the immediate future, and you just have to adapt to that and adjust to it. But I think that's changing. I mean, I think that that's... I just got offered a job where I'm just a cop, and it was not written for black or white. They just put me in it. I don't have to direct the damn thing. And Patsy Kensit's in it, and I saw... Wesley Snipes in Passenger 57,
right.
I think America's, you know, we're growing up a little bit. We've just got to get used to each other, and I think it's very important that we hurry up and do that. And I think media is very powerful. I mean, media can elect a president. So, or in Posse, for example, New Jack City would have been very easy for me. Let me take you on a Mario detour. Most of the times, traditionally, a black guy in an action movie is the commissioner, right? He goes, Magnum, bring it in on budget or have your badge. Am I right? Now, you've seen that role a million times, right?
It's like the guy in 48 Hours.
He's a
yelling
fixture.
At Nick Nolte.
He's a fixture. He's a black guy. And the reasoning is they say, well, gee, this is what we'll do, JB. We won't really put the guy in the front line. He won't have any fun. But we show a black guy in a position of authority. He's not dangerous. He doesn't have a gun. He just sort of walks around and has got some coffee. He says, I have your badge. Right? So when it came time to do New Jack City, I was talking with these two, some other folks and some of the producers on the show. And someone brought up the notion and said, well, why don't we put the white guy in as the police commissioner? And we'll go, Leroy, I'll have your badge. And just do the reverse. But the thing was, and I said, no, man, we can't do that because then we're just making reactive film. We're just doing the same thing that was done on us. And then no one's any better.
With all due respect, sir. I mean, you still don't get it. You're talking about a war out there that we're losing. You're not going to give me what I need to win. Now, I need some cops that know these streets. I need some New Jack cops to take down a New Jack gangster. What you call a risk? I think it's our only shot. Let's get out of here. Stone. Okay. You got your man. But I don't want any waves. Not a goddamn ripple.
So I said, hell with that. In an action movie, you want to be at the core of where the action is. So put Ice-T there, but also put Judd Nelson there. Also put Russell Wong, who's Asian there. You know what I mean? In the Posse, it's very easy for me to just make the Posse black, but put Stephen Baldwin in there and let us get used to each other. You know, and deal with that honestly. And that makes the dynamic more interesting. If you put Billy Zane in the movie, who's smart and bright, and that makes the sparks, that makes the dynamic much more interesting. That's why I think you take America, which is a crazy country and young, we're very young, and you take Afro-Americans and you take Italians and you take Chinese and Jews and you put them all in New York and you mix them up and you get great sparks. And there's fighting, but those cultural sparks make music. They make great art.
Standing on. We're back on top. We won't look down. Look at here.
Do you have any different perspective now on the controversy that surrounded New Jack City?
I had a guy ask me, the British guy said, Mario, tell me about the violence at New Jack City's opening. He said, do blacks, can they watch a movie without having a fight or so? And I said, Harold, tell me about the violence surrounding your soccer matches.
Mm-hmm.
Can you watch a soccer match? I said, do you think a soccer match is really a call to arms? He said, no. I said, it's probably a couple knuckleheads having a problem, right? It's more a reflection of that audience, is whatever, that society. LA Times did it very well, so I'll quote them on that. What the LA Times pointed out was the weekend that New Jack City opened was the same weekend that all week long, what had they seen on TV, they'd seen the Rodney King beating. All week long, audience had been watching the Rodney King beating. They went to see New Jack City that weekend. The people that had the riot in Westwood never got in to see the movie at all, never saw the movie.
The movie was oversold in some theaters,
the movie
right?
was oversold. I'm glad you know. People came down. I saw people down there, and I drove down there. People were waiting in line who had bought tickets, and they couldn't get in. The cops came down because Westwood wasn't used to seeing inner-city kids in those big numbers, and no one knew that the crowd, the response to New Jack City would be like that, that there would be so many people, and they had it in little teeny theaters. I mean, mm-hmm. that one screen where you had to watch with half an eye, they should have sold tickets for half price, but they had these little bitty screens. People couldn't get in. The cops came down and started moving people around, and someone yelled out, let's get him back for Rodney King. And this whole little riot ensued in Westwood. Well, the media came down and said, oh, what were these kids here to see? What was the problem? And what they saw was not Stallone with a big gun or Schwarzenegger with a big gun. They saw Wesley Snipes on the poster with a gun. So they said, you see, if a black guy has a gun and not a microphone or not a basketball, there's going to be a problem. And they must have seen the movie. Something in that movie must have been a call to arms. The ironic thing of that was that, as the LA Times pointed out, after they saw the movie, really, the cops were the heroes.
I've been authorized to set up an independent drug-fighting unit, and I'm picking you. Got it?
Why me?
Me, why you, man? You from the neighborhood? I can trust you. And I know you give a shit.
So what's the catch?
There's no catch, man. Why you gotta say that?
Because I know your ass, Stone.
Freddy here goes with you.
This big biscuit head looking...
Hey, listen up, Scotty. It's not gonna be another one of your wild-ass solo acts, man. Now, Freddy is the only cop I could find crazy enough to even team up with you.
It was kind of much to do about nothing but the wrong nothing. I mean, it sort of changed the focus from the content of the movie to other social issues that were going down at the time.
There's a tremendous amount of violence in New Jack City, but it's realistic violence of the street and of the circumstances those people find themselves in. But the key is, just as in its own way, whether you like these sorts of movies or not, the bad guys get blown away in traditional films of the past. Everybody who takes a wrong turn either gets his comeuppance at best or meets death at worst in New Jack City. I mean, the Wesley Snipes guy dies, and dies when people stand up and cheer, you know?
Well, now that's key. See, now you're hitting on what I think is key, because the bad guy dying is not always, doesn't always mean what it seems to mean. And if I can get into that for a second. One, addressing just the violent issue of New Jack, I could see Schwarzenegger, who I love, tear out more arms and Total Recall than you'd get ever in New Jack City. So if you really, New Jack City, a lot of the violence was created with tension and with realism versus a lot of guys blowing up stuff. I mean, Rambo mm-hmm. had more violence. All these big action movies, if you literally give a body count, and I did do this, I mean, I really sat there with a pen and paper, found New Jack City had less violence. But that's not here or there, because, you know, that's not a point I want to get into. But the point is this. Take a movie like Godfather, take a movie like Scarface, take a movie, those kind of films. What's interesting about a traditional gangster picture is that emotionally the audience
ties in with the gangster. In Godfather, you come away after watching 2.5 hours of a guy with family values who just happens to kill people for a living. But he's got family values. They're pulling me back in, you know. You know what I mean? You come away.
At least you're ambivalent. I don't know if you're completely on their side.
I'm telling you, the kids in the street. I'm not telling you, for me and you who can afford a different lifestyle. They have gangsters in the hood that call themselves Scarface. Because to them, the alternative being a janitor is not as bright as saying, hey, I'm going to live fast, I'm going to die young, and I'll be Scarface.
Right.
Do you know what I mean? But to them, emotionally, the hero of those movies was still the gangster. It was Scarface, and it was the Godfather. What's different in New Jack City is that they started out emotionally connected with the villain. And halfway through, we did some little things to take them around so they're rolling with the cops. And the way I did that was, in most of those gangster movies, they never show the victim. And so I had Chris Rock, who's funny and lovable and malleable and accessible, as the victim. And once you saw Chris Rock's character, Pookie, get on crack and what it did to him, his whole... how he lost his humanity and whatever he had, he lost. Kids were in the audience, man, standing up, talking about, just say no, damn it. So when you get that kind of reaction in mass against drugs from an audience that's going to see a gangster picture, that's a very interesting reaction.
And we're back with Mario Van Peebles. I remember very distinctly, more than 20 years ago, at Syracuse University, in an on-campus cinema, I saw Sweet Sweetback's Badass Song. Your dad, Melvin, made that film. I mean, talk about, it's an overblown word, but it was revolutionary for the time.
It's interesting. It was, and it taught me a lot. One, dad, by the way, my dad is in Posse, and he plays the old gunslinger that teaches my character how to shoot, so... He taught me how to shoot cinematically, so I thought, wouldn't it be great if he taught me how to shoot the six shooters?
That's cool.
He was one of the few guys to own his own negative. What happened with him was he set out to make, basically, Clint and I had talked about this at one point, a Clint Eastwood movie, basically with a black guy playing that role. At that point in history, if you said, don't step on my feet, that was a troublemaker. You're a revolutionary, if you're a black. So when he did Sweetback, he basically had the budget of, he'd gone to a guy who wanted to do a black porno movie, and the guy had written him a check and never expected this political movie to come out of it. And next time he looked over, my dad had spent $1 million. He goes, what the hell? And then when the movie came out and became the top grossing independent hit for that year, the guy was like, I knew it all the time, me and Mel go way back. But no one wanted to invest in the movie.
And that success, despite the fact that at the beginning, a lot of theaters wouldn't show it.
Two theaters in the whole United States.
That's why I mentioned that I saw it on campus, because right. I'm not sure if I could have gone out into the city and seen it. I haven't seen Sweetback since, but I think I recall it pretty well. And one thing that was great about it, in addition to the storyline, which has your father, he's literally a stud, a takeoff on the stereotype of the black sexual stud. He's performing in exhibitions for the amusement primarily of white audiences, and generally he's compliant with the powers that be, but when he watches this revolutionary guy being beat up by the
police... It was like a king situation.
Yeah, like a Rodney King, they drag him in the alley, beat him up. Something clicks in the guy's head, and he goes off, and he beats them up like with their own baton or handcuffs or something, and he takes off. Right. He's a fugitive. He's like David Jansen. He's the black David Jansen on the run, and he's doing everything he can think of resourcefully to keep eluding the authorities and to maintain his dignity. But in addition to that, the shots of black street life, which then had not been seen in that kind of showcase, just the bleakness of it and the way life had beaten people down, and you could see it in their faces, the resignation in their voices. Mm-hmm. I thought that undercurrent was a great part of the movie.
It was, and he didn't have to go far to get it. I mean, he really went in and shot the hood as it was. And what was interesting, and this is the thing, this is why, back to why I did Posse, because it comes directly out of what you're talking about with Sweetback. After he did Sweet Sweetback's Badass Song, the studio started pressing out these movies with black stars and big afros, and they made Shaft, and they made Superfly, and they
they just were putting them out, and after a while they had white directors just directing black actors. They still called them black films. It's like me making movies with Irish actors and calling them Irish films, and then when the Irish films that I'm making don't make money, I say, well, Irish films don't make money anymore. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
So Hollywood's a tricky place, because if you make Jaws and Orca and alligators that eat people, you make those kind of movies and people stop seeing them, they don't say white movies don't make money, they say fish movies don't make money. But in the 70s,
yeah,
when they said, well, we got Shaft goes to the 7-Eleven and Superfly goes to save on drugs, and we're making these sequels, if those stopped making money, you know what they said? They said black movies aren't making money.
Sure.
Which is why now, I felt, now 20 years later, you've got the kids that grew up seeing those movies as filmmakers. I think it's very important that I do a Western and we step out, resist the temptation to just go right to New Jack 2 or 3 and do a Western, that Spike does X, that Bill Duke directs a film about three Jewish women called Cemetery Club, that we just, you know, Coppola's Italian-American, but he doesn't get locked into a cinematic ghetto. He can go off and do Apocalypse Now, and No One's Eating Pasta, and he can go do Rumblefish, and he can come back and do Godfather 2. And the more that we diversify and just go across those lines, the better. I mean, I think the more we just become filmmakers, and I think that's the future. But I think people like Melvin Van Peebles and Ozzie Davis and those first guys helped open the door.
The movie is Posse. We're out of here. See you later. Thanks a lot.
Oh, man. Thanks for having me on.
Okay.